Hello, my name is Keshwani.
That's K-E-S-H-W-A-N-I, Keshwani.
Today we'll have our 95th lesson, day number 95, in our vocabulary series. Vocabulary words, day number 95. Let's begin then, shall we? The first two or three words that we're going to learn today, all of these words will have to do with something being disgusting, horrible, repulsive. Repulsive, just terrible, bad, you don't want to deal with it, it's dirty, it's foul. Let's learn the first word, shall we? The word is it's an adjective, and the word is sordid. What does it mean, sordid? Well, sordid means exactly what we just said. It means filthy, disgusting, something that is dirty, something that is foul, something that is squalid. I know all about their sordid affair. I know all about their sordid affair. I know they had an affair. I know all about it. Not only you know all about it, but you go on to express your opinion about it. But you're not neutral about it. You have a strong opinion on it because you just described it as sordid, filthy, disgusting affair. Again, the word is sordid. It's filthy, disgusting, dirty, foul. Finally, squalid. The difference between the word squalid, listen very carefully, okay? Let's learn the difference between the word squalid and sordid. The difference between the word squalid, listen very carefully, is that here, this is where the nuances lie. This word is used more in the physical sense of the word, physical sense. When you're describing something as in physical condition, for example, you might talk about squalid conditions of prisons. One might talk about squalid conditions of prisons. Or one might talk about squalid conditions of slums. Or one might talk about squalid conditions of shanty towns, if you like. Shanty towns and slums are the same. Or one might talk about squalid conditions of, where can I squeeze it? Favelas. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. It's a Portuguese word. In Brazil, particularly in Rio, when we talk about shanty towns, when we talk about slums, the slums in Brazil and particularly in Rio, they use the word favelas to describe them. They are slums. They are shanty towns. And if you were to go there, you will see that the people live in squalid condition. In that context, it would not sound very right. It will not sound very proper. It will not sound very correct to say they live in sordid condition. The word proper, appropriate word would be squalid, because this word, as I said, is used more in the physical sense of the word. Whereas over here, you're describing something conceptual, as in sordid affair, squalid conditions of prison, slums, shanty towns, favelas, and so forth. Let's learn the next word. Next word is a little bit different, but still in the same idea, which means something being unpleasant. Let's learn it. But the next word is unpleasant in the sense that it causes horror. It's unpleasant because it causes horror, not necessarily because it's dirty. And the word is, it's a very simple word. I don't even know why I have it here. The word is ghastly. It's an adjective. Ghastly simply means something that causes horror or terror, if you like.
or dread.
Something that causes dread, something that causes horror, something that causes
what else did I say?
Horror, terror, dread is said to be ghastly. Something that is frightening.
Something that is
something that frightens you, something that makes you scared, is ghastly. That scene was ghastly. The story is ghastly. The murder was ghastly. It was horrible, disgusting murder. The scene of the murder was ghastly.
Something that is frightening. ING, frightening.
Something that is disgusting.
Something that is disgusting. Let's erase all of this thing. Something that was disgusting. Something that is horrible. Something that is repugnant. Something that is extremely unpleasant. Extremely unpleasant.
Again, you can use it very loosely, and you can talk about being in somebody's ghastly company. That means you find their company very unpleasant. Do you understand? He's a ghastly fellow. He's a very unpleasant fellow. It was a ghastly scene. The word is ghastly. That's it. We've done those three words. I wanted to get those three words out of my system, and we have done so. The next word that we're going to talk about, let's put it on the blackboard first. It's a peculiar word in the sense that it has two very different meaning. One is a verb, one is a noun, depending on how it is pronounced. So we're going to put them right next to each other, a nice juxtaposition, and we'll talk about them, okay? The word that I just used was juxtaposition. We'll learn that in a second. So we're going to put them next to each other. Nice juxtaposition. If you pronounce this as con, as console, it's a verb. To console someone. If you pronounce that as console is a noun. Let's talk about console first. What does it mean to console? It's a verb, as I said. If it's a verb, it has to mean to do something. To console someone means to comfort someone. To console someone
to comfort someone in their time of grief or their loss or their sadness.
If you just found out that your friend's father passed away, you want to go and console him. You want to go and console her. You want to make her feel better. You want to
comfort the person in their time of grief, in their time of loss, in their time of sadness.
And the verb would be console. And the noun of console is, this is a noun. The noun of this word, console, is
notice what happens. It changes the pronunciation. The first syllable, sort of kan, becomes kan.
It's a very tricky word, as I said before.
Same syllable as this one, but it's a noun of this word. Consolation.
One more time. Consolation. One more time.
Consolation. What I want you to pay attention to is the fact that as a verb is console, as a noun it becomes kan, consolation.
Consolation is the verb of console. I left a couple of cookies on the counters. They're not there. Did you eat them? Yes, I did eat those cookies. And if it's any consolation to you, they were very yummy. See, I'm trying to comfort the person. I ate the cookies. The person is upset. I'm trying to comfort him. I'm trying to make him feel better by saying that if it's any consolation to you, they were very yummy. I enjoyed them. Thank you. Do you understand? Of course, you're being silly, obviously. What's the antonym? The antonym is somebody who cannot be consoled. Somebody who cannot be consoled is said to be inconsolable. Inconsolable simply means that person is suffering with so much grief, so much sadness, so much of a loss, that there is no way that you can make them feel better, that you can comfort them. They are inconsolable. Consolable means you can console them. You can show some consolation. You can make them feel better. And if you cannot achieve that, you will say that he was inconsolable. It goes back to k. Inconsolable. Consolation. Consolation, console. Let's talk about this word. This is, of course, you know it probably. Console. Console is a noun, which is a very simple word, I know that. Let's erase this thing so we have room to write. A console is simply a decorative bracket for supporting a shelf. It can also be a cabinet for a radio or television. A television or a stereo, which is designed to stand on a floor by itself. You know what a console is. Console is a cabinet. You put it on the floor and you put your television in there, you put your stereo in there, you put your TV in there. It stands by itself on the floor. And that's called a console. A console and console. My console, I broke my console, lucky for me. My brother was there to console me. He showed me a great deal of consolation. Let's learn the last word that we put here before, which is juxtaposition. Juxtaposition simply means putting two things next to each other for comparison purposes. Right here we have a nice juxtaposition of this word here with two different pronunciations, console and console. Something like this, when you put two things next to each other for comparison purposes, that is called juxtaposition. Let's learn it, shall we? On the top. Pronunciation is very important, obviously, as always. Juxtaposition. Po, it's not po, it's po. Zish, it has a z sound, z sound, zis, un. Juxtaposition. Juxtaposition simply means
putting two things next to each other, as we said before. Putting two things next to each other for comparison purposes. Putting two things side by side. Side by side. Or if you like, next to each other. Or if you like, next to each other. 4. For comparison purposes.
4. Comparison purposes.
Juxtaposition is a noun. The verb would be juxtapose. Juxtapose.
Notice again. It has a Z sound at the end. Juxtapose, which means two placed side by side.
I think side by side should be hyphenated. I'm not sure about whether or not side by side should be hyphenated. I don't think it's hyphenated. To place side by side.
To place side by side is exactly what we had done before with the two words console and console. We put them side by side. That was, we juxtaposed the two meanings so that we could compare them, so that we can look at each other right next to each other, so that we can compare them, so that we can talk about them. It can be two paintings, for example. You may have two paintings on the wall. It might be same subject, it might be different subjects. It all depends. You might have two paintings of Eiffel Tower, one during the daytime, one during the nighttime, and you have them on the wall next to each other. That's a nice juxtaposition. You might have two paintings of two different animals, or you might have two paintings, one might be urban setting, one might be rural setting, and you put them next to each other, and that's called a juxtaposition. It simply means placing two things next to each other so that the viewer or reader can compare them visually. Do you understand? That's all I had for today. We'll meet again tomorrow on day number 96. Okay? Bye now.